And we do hope that you will jump on the phones, 800-333-1190 or 447-1190, and ask a question about how you can get off the diabetes train. You know, type 2 diabetes is an epidemic all across this country. About 40% of the people in our area are pre-diabetic. They're headed down that path. And type 2, of course, adult onset diabetes, is the most prevalent style. So we're going to talk about how you can actually reverse that by making 11 lifestyle changes. And our guest on this segment is nutritionist Diana Lacalze. Good to see you again, Diana. Thanks for coming in.
Hi, Lee. Thanks for having me.
She is out there traveling right now. Kenny, I didn't hear her response, so if you can work that out for us. She's got a program that you have access to for at no cost at all, absolutely free. You can go to the Health Call Facebook page, and you will see there a link to a free 7-day meal plan is the starting point. And then there are some other products that we're going to talk about in a second that you can learn more about. So can I really reverse type 2 diabetes, even though I'm deep in the disease, I've been taking metformin forever? Can I really reverse that with just lifestyle changes?
So to answer your question, it really does depend. So type 2 diabetes, it is a condition that's caused by lifestyle factors. So generally, it's caused by a combination of poor diet and a lack of physical activity. Now, genetics do play a role, but only to a small degree. And a person is diagnosed with type 2 diabetes when their glucose levels or their blood sugar reaches above a certain threshold. So if you are able to change your lifestyle behaviors and tackle that root cause of diabetes, so not just tackling the symptoms of high glucose, but really tackling that underlying issue, then yes, there is potential to reverse it. And when I say reverse it, I define that as getting your blood glucose levels down to a normal level, to clinically normal range, and keeping it there. Now, I do want to say that if someone has had diabetes for many, many years and their pancreas is overworked, so meaning it's spent years overproducing insulin, then there is a risk that the cells on their pancreas do eventually die and cease to work. So if that is the case, so if you have had diabetes for an extended amount of time, 20 years or so, and your pancreas has been affected, then it may be difficult to truly reverse diabetes, but that doesn't mean it can't be controlled or something can be done for it.
Gotcha. And, you know, I think this also applies to those people who are in what's called metabolic syndrome, but where you're not officially diagnosed with type 2, but you've got the high blood pressure, the obesity, and all those other factors that put you on the path for type 2 diabetes, right?
Exactly. And if you can kind of get in there and tackle some of those issues while you're on the path, you're going to have a much better chance of truly reversing diabetes. And a lot of the same modifications that you can do for diabetes will also help you resolve some of those other issues as well.
You bet. So their change is hard for people. Lifestyles are set, we're cranky and old and in our ways, right? And if I can only change half of the things in your plan, am I going to get half the benefit?
You will absolutely see results. So it depends on how much effort you do want to put into it, because it does require some effort. It's not a magic bullet. So the biggest factors that we see that contribute to type 2 diabetes are your diet, so your nutrition, and your physical activity. So if you can really just focus on those two areas, you're going to see a huge impact in your health and in reversing diabetes.
So the biggest challenge for me, and the number one on your list, is to move to a plant-based diet, get away from animal products like meat, eggs, and dairy. Man, that's a heavy lift. That's a tough one. What's the connection between those saturated fats and diabetes?
It is a tough one. And I'm not saying you have to go 100% plant-based. It's definitely not what I'm saying. But I'm saying that by reducing these fatty foods in your diet, you're going to see a huge impact in your blood glucose levels and the underlying cause of type 2 diabetes. So a lot of people think that they have to limit carbs to tackle diabetes. But what that does is just handles the symptoms. So if you don't eat carbs, your glucose isn't going to spike. But that doesn't really solve the underlying issue of type 2 diabetes, which is insulin resistance. And in the research, and there is quite a lot of research, is showing that when we eat a diet that's high in saturated fatty acids, so it's a type of fat and it's often referred to as unhealthy fat. When we eat a lot of those fats, it starts to accumulate in cells where it's not meant to go. So it starts to accumulate in our muscle cells, in our liver cells. And what happens is that starts to build up and it interferes with the cell's ability to respond and interact with insulin. So if insulin can't do its job, which is to open the channels and allow glucose to funnel in, if insulin can't do that, then the glucose is just going to linger in your blood.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, so and it causes all kinds of vascular damage and eventually it's just a horrible disease that you need to avoid it at all costs. And one of the things that you suggest, some of these changes are fairly simple. So meatless Monday, that sounds pretty easy. One day a week, just go without a meat product.
Exactly. So when people think plant-based diets, they think it's a really drastic change, but you don't need to go from 0 to 100. It's all about finding, you know, little changes that you can make to your lifestyle that's really going to work for you. And one way we advocate for doing that is to try Meatless Mondays, which is one day of the week going completely meat-free. So if you can challenge yourself to that, it's a great place to start.
Easier than ever today as well. There are so many meat-free products out there, meat-free meatballs even, that you know aren't vegetable-based, and they're not bad. They don't taste too bad. So move away from dairy products, easier to do than ever as well. Instead of milk, what should I be looking at?
So I would recommend non-dairy milks. There's a lot of options now available. I would just definitely choose the unsweetened variations because you definitely want to limit the sugar in your diet as well.
So soy, almond, oat milk, those kinds of things.
Yes, exactly.
And this is a great tip. I never thought of this, but when you're making a restaurant choice, when you're going out to eat, as more of us will, now that the pandemic seems to be at least closer to being under control, eat ethnic foods. What's the hit there?
So what we found is a lot of ethnic foods do offer some option, whether that's a vegetarian or vegan dish. So when you go to a Thai restaurant, Japanese restaurant, they usually will have vegetarian options because it's part of their culture, incorporating vegetarian and vegan foods into their diet.
That sounds great. One last thing before we take a break, and that is more fiber. What does fiber have to do with diabetes?
So fiber is one of the most important nutrients we can eat in our diet. And about 95% of Americans don't eat enough fiber. So fiber is found in a lot of plant-based foods. And people who eat sufficient amount of fiber actually have they're able to control their weight better, and they're able to prevent chronic illnesses like diabetes. Because fiber, what it does is it actually helps slow down the absorption of glucose into our bloodstream. It kind of blocks it from being entered, so it's entered at a much slower pace. And it also helps to actually lower cholesterol. It will bind to cholesterol and help you remove it through your bowels. So it's kind of a two for one. You know, fiber is such an important nutrient.
We're going to move through some of these other lifestyle changes kind of quickly here, Diana. Another important one is just move more, right? Get off your couch.
Yes, exactly. The human body was meant to move, and it just works better when it's active. And there's tons of studies that show just incorporating more exercise can lower your blood glucose levels. It can improve your heart health. It can improve blood pressure and just overall quality of life. So it is just so important to incorporate some sort of movement, physical activity into your daily routine.
And it can be just 20 minutes a day, a brisk walk, doesn't have to be crazy exotic, just anything helps, right?
Exactly. Anything helps. You could do a 20 minute at home workout or just go for a walk, especially after your meals too, because that'll really help bring down glucose levels.
Yeah, with the weather changing, get out and take that walk after dinner and help you a lot. So when you are hungry, drink water first. Tell me about that.
So more than half of the human body is made up of water. It's just so important for overall hydration. It helps to flush out waste and toxins, regulate our body temper, and just so much more. And a lot of Americans tend to drink their calories. So in the form of sugary sweetened beverages like soda, iced teas, or juice. And that all that sugar really increases your risk of not only developing type 2 diabetes, but a whole host of other chronic illnesses. Again, it's just a lot of sugar for our body. So by replacing some of those sugary sweetened beverages with water, which is zero calories, zero sugar, it's just going to be so much better for your overall health. And oftentimes we do confuse thirst for hunger. So we tend to go for food instead of water. And in reality, we're just pretty thirsty. So sometimes it can help satiate us.
And you you suggest using an app or a smart bottle? What's that?
So they have smart bottles now, of course, that will actually remind you to drink water throughout the day. It'll have a little timer and it'll beep when you need to drink some water.
Oh, of course. Well, there is. There's a smart bottle. Of course there is. Yeah. Hey, we had a caller curious about if we are trying to avoid animal products, is fish okay to be on the diet?
So fish definitely has less saturated fat than meat and dairy. So I would say, yes, it's definitely fine, especially if you're trying to reduce those more fatty, meaty products. The fish is a good source of omega-3s, which is a healthy fat. But overall, you'll see the biggest bang for your buck when you just reduce overall animal intake. You'll see a very drastic change.
And then I assume you're going to push us to beans and other products like that for the protein that we need, right?
Absolutely. So any source of any bean. So there's just so many varieties of beans out there. Mm-hmm, tofu, sure. Edamame, lentils. They're all going to be great sources of lean protein, meaning they have none of that fat, none of that unsaturated fat. And they are also full of fiber. So not only are you getting none of that saturated fat, but you'll also benefit from the high amounts of fiber that we talked about, which are so beneficial to our health.
I am fascinated by this idea of eating mindfully. Now, mindfulness is kind of being in the moment, taking stock of where you're at, what's happening in your life to kind of center yourself and bring down your stress level. How do I apply that to the food and the eating process? And how does that help me?
Okay. So yes, exactly what you said. Mindfulness is being just present in the moment. And so we can apply that same concept to our eating and dining experience, basically just being present when you are having and eating your food. So you can do this by really focusing on the texture, the smell, the taste of your food. And it really allows you to enhance more conscious eating. And it can actually improve your relationship with food. So there is research that shows mindful eating can help control certain eating behaviors like binge eating and emotional eating. And with diabetes specifically, some studies even show that those who practice mindfulness see a significant decrease in their A1C. So it can be a very powerful tool to implement.
So I read in one of your guidelines, eating in front of a television or with distractions is awful for you. Tell me more about that.
Right. So when you're eating in front of a TV, you aren't present, right? So your mind is elsewhere. You're focused on other activities. And a lot of the time you tend to just rush through your meal because your attention is somewhere else. So that's why we definitely urge people to really sit in front of their food and have that just be time dedicated to eating and just eating so you can really focus.
And then the other side of that is something we have talked about before on the program, and I live this life, intermittent fasting. So I think my audience probably is up to speed on that a little bit, but so kind of walk us through that quickly and how that helps.
So intermittent fasting, it helps your body burn more fat because you are allowing it to kind of switch into a different metabolic state. And by not eating, you're kind of just giving your body a little bit of a rest because we eat a lot. Americans tend to eat all day. And by fasting, you can kind of give your body that break that it needs. And an approach you can do, which is one of the most common approaches, is the 16-8 approach, where you eat all your daily calories in an 8-hour window and you fast for 16 hours. And you can, I recommend as a dietitian to have that feeding window earlier in the day. So some people will start at 12 and then stop eating at like 8, for example. And you'll see much better results if you can just shift that earlier in the day and end your last meal a little bit earlier.
And I agree. Yeah, I do it 10:30. 10:30 till 7 p.m. are the hours of the day in which I will allow myself to eat anything. Otherwise, it's just water or sometimes wine, which I know is not really the right thing to do. But it does make a difference. And you're reducing your total calorie intake. But again, the big change is you're not asking your body to produce or to process those calories. And so your body goes into sort of a maintenance state and does some cellular level cleanup. So that's kind of the benefits of intermittent fasting.
Yeah, and there have been a lot of great studies done, especially people with type 2 diabetes, where people who do incorporate intermittent fasting improve their insulin sensitivity, and then they also improve their blood pressure and inflammation in their body. So there are some tremendous benefits to it.
Supported by the American College of Cardiologists, they're now on board saying a Mediterranean diet and intermittent fasting, the healthiest way to live for your heart, and therefore I'm assuming also to fight type 2 diabetes. These other lifestyle restrictions, not really restrictions, but changes that you want to make, is just to reduce stress. Talk me through that. Sounds good.
Yeah. So stress is a big one. Everyone is stressed out these days, just the lives we live. And so stress can trigger the adrenal glands to secrete the hormone cortisol. And basically what cortisol does, it prepares the body's response to to whatever stress you're experiencing by flooding the body with glucose. So that's why it's really important, specifically for people with diabetes, to have a handle on their stress, because stress is just going to continue to keep your glucose levels high.
Well, I have to tell you, Diana, I'm stressed because we've run out of time and I got to close things up. That is Diana LaCalzi. You can go to reversingt2d.com. That is reversingt2d.com, and sign up for a totally free 7-day meal plan there if you wish. It's also linked up on the Health Call Facebook page. Diana, thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me.
You bet. We'll get to connect with you again in the future. And thank you for joining us. Love having you here. Look forward to being with you again next week for another edition of the Health Call Live Radio Hour on WoWo. You can always listen to the podcast and all the major services, or just go to WoWo.com and look for podcast there. Great to be with you. Take care of yourself. Try a little bit of lifestyle change, and let's kick that type 2 diabetes right out the door. We'll see you next week.